We've already been hitched, and He intends for us to enjoy the blessings and privileges of that relationship in the present. Happy is the man or woman who's able to do so. And yet, we still wait for Him to come. Jesus told His disciples the night before He died that He went to prepare a place for them and that He would come again and take them to Himself that they might be with Him always. A few weeks ago, I told how I came from where I was living in Salina, Kansas, to claim my bride and start our home together. Jesus is likewise coming for us. In verse 2, she speaks again, and she relates an experience she had. In verse 1, they've come together. As I see it, she's resting in His love, and He's warned those watching not to wake her. But a part of her was already awake. That's what she described. In her sleep, she heard a voice, and it was His. She heard him knocking and asking her to open to Him. We will read in verses 6 and 7 of her going back out into the city by night, again to search for Him, just as we did back in chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. Now, we didn't treat that passage as a dream. Was it? Or had it actually happened? See, that's what Jesus' disciples surely asked themselves. Was this really happening? Or were they going to wake up and find that it had all been a dream? The things that they witnessed simply don't happen in real life. She slept in a state of watchfulness. Jesus had something to say to us about being in a state of watchfulness, did He not? She was asleep, but her heart was awake. Oh, to have an awakened heart. Love will do that to a person, you know. Love has woken many a person who previously were deadened in their spirit. Love has caused them to take interest again. Sometimes you'll hear people tell how they never felt so alive as when they were in love. And it's true. Love is what we were designed for. And our soul rises to it. Before I met Suzanne, you know, I thought I was alive. I thought I was living it up at the frat house with all that partying. But it had devolved into just drinking until I was in something of a fog. Now, I snapped out of it to a large degree when I met Suzanne. I poured myself into our relationship, and the alcohol wasn't needed as formerly. But I didn't really start living until I experienced the love of God in Christ Jesus. And when I did, I awoke to new life. And my prayer for you, as we go through the song, is that something in you will awaken. He was knocking. His head was drenched with the dew, for while she'd been sleeping, he'd been out in the night, doing what we're not told. In the song, she rests, but we never read of the bridegroom sleeping. For as the 121st Psalm says, "He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep." While she was sleeping, he went out doing whatever needed to be done. Somebody has to battle the giants. Now his attention had turned to her, and he called to her to rise and open to him. But she was tucked away in her bed for the night. To open, she would need to put her dress back on, and she would dirty her feet again. The timing of his visit wasn't good. So at first she resisted the idea of getting saw his hand reaching through the opening. And I want you to think about that image. She sees his hand reaching through the opening of the gate, and she was moved. So aroused were her feelings for him that her hands oozed as she reached for the gate latch. She opened. But then he was gone. And this is exactly the type of thing that happens in a dream. Her heart had gone out to him as he spoke. Why did she delay to answer? Now she searched for him, but to no avail. She called out his name, but there was no answer. So she goes out again into the city to search for her love. Except this time, the watchmen didn't simply wonder at her presence. They made sport of her. They struck her and removed a portion of her clothing. Now, she tells this matter-of-factly. She doesn't go into the abuse, the details of it, or how it made her feel. She was entirely focused on finding her love. In the dream, the crime against her person took place, but it was tangential to the main story. All over the world, you see, people are suffering for the sake of Christ. They're being mistreated. They're being struck and having property confiscated. I mean, all you got to do, and I hope you will, is just read the monthly newsletter from Voice of the Martyrs. Their pain is great, and we must pray for them as we would only hope that the others would be praying for us if we were in their shoes. But as Paul wrote in Romans 8:18, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that is to be revealed in us. The suffering is part of the story, but it will so soon be swallowed up in glory as not to matter. And that's the way that the song reads, and it accords with the rest of Scripture. Love comes with a cost, a great cost. But the cost is nothing compared to the surpassing value of knowing Christ. All that is lost is nothing compared to what is found. What are we to make of this dream sequence included in the song? You know, dreams can be terrible and yet wonderful. They remind us that there is a world beyond the one we wake up to each day. The maddening thing about dreams is that they're out of our control. One minute he was there, and the next he's outside the gate knocking. I think this points to the mystical quality of our relationship with God. This relationship, like his presence, it comes to us. We cannot produce it as much as we'd like to. And on the one hand, this is terrible to us. We want to be able to produce it. We want to feel him near us every moment. And yet on the other hand, when we do feel and experience him, it's wonderful. You know, Jacob, he woke from the dream that we call Jacob's ladder. And he said, surely the Lord's in this place. And I didn't know it. So moved was Jacob that he set up a makeshift altar and made a vow to the one who had appeared to him in such a way. God was with Jacob all the time. And that was the truth that he eventually came to understand. But it sure didn't seem like it when his father-in-law slipped the wrong girl into his tent and later changed his wages 10 times. It didn't seem like God was with him, you know, when he suffered under the heat of the day and the frost of the ground by night, those disciples that Jesus was risen, and that he was going ahead of them to Galilee, and that there they would see him. John's gospel records a figure on the shore engaging them and telling them to cast out their nets. He served them breakfast, and then was gone. Jesus' final words as he ascended to heaven to his disciples were, "And lo, I'm with you always." He was always there, and still is. But sometimes they got to see it. And sometimes we get to see it too. Perhaps not as often or as tangibly as we would like. If such moments are rare, they're also precious. We cannot manufacture them. We come to this gathering week after week, hoping that he might reveal himself to us. Most Sundays are like every other. But then, Isaiah, who records a life-changing experience he had in chapter 6, the prophecy named after him. He walked into the temple as he'd done countless times previously. But this time he saw it. Well, God had been there all those other times, too. If we want things to happen on our timetable, and Charles was, adding his testimony to that truth here earlier, but if we want things to happen on our timetable, we're going to be frustrated in our relationship with God. We like certainty. We want to think that if we just do certain things, certain other things will happen. We decide to start reading our Bibles and praying more. But where's God? Why don't we experience him? We start back to church regularly, thinking that if we do, God will show up and seem real to us. But where is he? I think this passage reveals the truth, and that is that if God did show up, we might find ourselves reluctant, at least at first, to do what he asked. It might scare us to death, as it did Isaiah. Or he might just show up at an inconvenient time and interrupt all of our plans. This God of ours, he's mysterious. He lies outside the world of our waking. If we had our way, we would set the table, make everything predictable, and limit him to doing things as we think he should. But the table that he set for us is full of surprises. We wish to control him and dictate terms, but he cannot be reduced to that. The love he calls us to is an adventure. And if we're honest, isn't that the love that our hearts dream of? He's promised to come for us. Oh, but yet he hasn't chosen to tell us where we're going on our honeymoon. We don't even know the date of the big day. Our portion is to love whom we cannot see. I want you to look at what Peter had to say in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8. In verses 6 and 7, he spoke of the proving of our faith through trials. Let's read verses 6 to 8. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you've not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory. verse 7, Peter wrote of the praise, glory, and honor that will be the portion of those whose faith proved genuine on the day that our Lord shows up. He will come in glory and reveal himself. But that is then. What about now? Having not seen him, as Peter wrote in verse 8, we love him. After showing Thomas his hands and his side, Jesus said, "Blessed are those, Thomas, who see or who believe without seeing." Some things are beyond us. And what I'm asking this morning is, aren't you glad? It's my prayer that you will be able to embrace that. And even revel in it. The one to whom we belong is so great as to defy human understanding. Next week I'll drill down on verse 9 of our text. And we shall turn our attention to the chorus of onlookers, how they function in the song, and what their words and involvement might mean for us. But before moving on, let's look at her words again in verse 8. She invokes the help of the other girls, and she asks them to get a message to her lover if they come across him. And that message is that she's lost. Her heart yearns for him, and she is not well in his absence. And is this not the case for us? When we're doing good, it's when we feel him near, when we can see him at work in our lives, and when we feel like we're hearing his voice. Such moments are precious, and he would actually like us to experience more of them. It's his desire that we have an awakened heart, ever alert to the possibility of his presence, and yet loving him even when he cannot be seen. It all has to start with an interesting God. You know, if you don't have that, then I can't place it there for you. Robert Farrar Capon said this: "You'll be interested in God's existence only if in advance of proof you care about the subject. And that depends on more than mere existence. What does it matter to you if I can prove that lobsters exist if you don't like lobsters? For starters, you see, there has to be an affection. I mean, and what's the song about if not affection? In the song, I believe God reveals his affection for us, and that in a fresh and surprising way, in hopes that it will arouse some feelings in us. The Scottish preacher Thomas Chalmers, his best-known message was entitled "The Expulsive Power of a New Affection," to which I'll ask, do you struggle in being able to give certain things up? As he points out, a new affection for Christ is the only thing powerful enough to displace the things that you presently have your heart set on. And many testify to that power. Before we lived for one thing, but now God has become our highest thought and our favorite topic of conversation. The prayer of our hearts now is, "Come, Lord Jesus." And why is it? It's because we're lovesick. We struggle with why he can't be visible to us at all times. "I opened to my beloved," she said, "but he turned and gone away." Why? And that perhaps is a question that we need to come to terms with. First, let me say that we may never get an answer to our question, and we may just have to trust. Perhaps there's something to be gained in the temporary absence. Perhaps there's something to be learned in having to maintain a long-distance relationship. And then maybe, just maybe, he is there for those with eyes to see. here's a short answer. It didn't matter that they beat her. She was undeterred. It didn't matter what her brothers or any others thought. She would pursue her love. She was totally focused on him and not friends. Can anyone be pure of heart, you ask, given that we have so many things competing for our attention and that we must be about? But even as the bride slept, and yet her heart was awake, it's possible for us to tend to all the things we must care for and still have a heart that's focused on you. I shared with you how my heart's focused on my wife and all my comings and goings and how I run home to her. But I'm also focused on my Lord. I cherish my time. The promise to those whose heart is set on God is that they will see him. He will show up. He will show up at the revealing of Jesus Christ, and he's there now to be seen by those who look for him and whose hearts are awakened to his presence. Our beloved, he's dazzling and ruddy. He's outstanding among 10,000. His head is like gold, pure gold. His locks are like clusters of dates and black as a raven. His eyes are like doves beside streams of water, bathed in milk and reposed in their setting. His cheeks like a bed of balsam, banks of sweet scented herbs. His lips are lilies, dripping with wine. His hands are rods of gold set with beryl. His abdomen is carved ivory, inlaid with sapphires. His legs are pillars of alabaster, set on pedestals of pure gold. His appearance is like Lebanon, choice as the cedars. His mouth is full of sweetness, and he is wholly desirable. This is our beloved. And this is our friend. Let's pray. Lord, open our hearts to the love that you revealed to us here in the song. Let our hearts be able to sense your hand reaching to us through the opening in the gate. Wake us up, Lord, to your presence. And Lord, as you call out to us, we pray for the grace that in us you would place a response, that you'd give an affection. Lord, we know it won't be equal to yours, for there's no one that loves like you. But God, it's our prayer that we might rise up and love you, Lord, with a love that's even to yours and worthy of yours. Lord, let your love come to be what our life is all about. Let it be what we think about. Let it be what we're drawn towards and hope of. Let it be what we're